All ready to praise the Lord?
Yeah.
All right, because that's like the main thing we're going to do here today. We're going to have some fun, praise the Lord. We're going to go ahead and get started. We have three more receiving their first communion, and that's going to be a good time for us to celebrate them and their continued maturity in the faith. We're also going to be celebrating LWML Sunday, so Suzanne Rasmussen's going to be doing a children's message for us. We're going to be celebrating all that they do here at Trinity and around the world. Also, on the announcement side, two quick things coming up. Next weekend, after the late service, we're going to be getting together in the fellowship hall for a quick little meeting. And then in 2 weeks, we will be having our congregational meeting between services starting at 9:30. So come check that out. Lots of fun stuff that's going to be announced. And I do believe that there's an LWML rep here to spread some good news. Let me grab you a microphone. It's the blue one, Brecken. It's not on. All right. It's on now. There you go, Wendy.
Good morning. My name is Wendy Carlson. I am here representing LWML. And I know that's a mouthful. But put simply, we are Lutheran Women in Mission. So we are a sisterhood. We are devoted to Bible study and to prayer. We've been inspired by our Savior towards service in our church, our community, and abroad. We are faithful in our collection of mites to fund the efforts of sharing the gospel. We are joyful in fellowship as we grow in connection with our Heavenly Father and each other. These are some of the faces of LWML. So we would love for all the ladies of Trinity to join us in our sisterhood. There's a table at the back with information, or grab one of us. That's why we're standing, is so you can see the ladies of the LWML, and we hope that you would seek us out and ask what we're involved in. We will be having the noisy bucket or the mite box collection at the end of the month, and we'll have a ladies' advent service in December. So we invite you all to join us. God's blessings as you serve.
Thank you, Wendy. Well, folks, it's time to stand up and praise the Lord. So let's get on both of your feet, get both your hands in the air, maybe,
yeah.
And let's praise the Lord, huh?
Good.
Let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. Oh, free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great. I know you will do it.
things indeed. And so we glorify his name. We give his name all the glory, and it's right to begin there also. We begin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to take some time right now at the beginning of the service for our children's message. So if you're 41 years old and younger, you can come on down. 41 years old and younger, you can come on down. I see you, Ari. I see you. Bring your nephew, too. Let's go. Chase can come down with you. Yeah, Chase. Yeah, man. Don't forget little James. All right, here we go. Four more. All right. What's up, men and women?
Thank you.
All right. As they make their way back to their families, let's stand up as we prepare to confess our need for this Jesus. One of the blessings to watch the kids participate in their own way in the mission of the church, the communication of the good news of Jesus for everyone, every single person, is to empower them to follow and to be an active agent, not just the recipient. What a great way for the LWML to come alongside our children and to activate them as little missionaries wherever they live. Friends, we'll continue with our confession that we need to be rescued, that we need Jesus. Let's say these words together. Almighty God, we are continually pretending to be someone we are not. Knowing the power of the cross, we are still reluctant to recognize the reality of our sin. By the power of the Holy Spirit, we confess, I have limits. I am not strong enough. I am broken. We continue. Make us new today for the glory of your holy name. Amen. Friends, in the name and by the sacrifice of Christ, you are made new. Not mostly new, not somewhat new, not factory refurbished new. You are made to be brand new, fully new. And when the King returns, he will make you forever new. And he does all of this by the power and the authority of his word. So hear his word for you today. Friends, your sins, all of your sins, every single last one of your sins, they're forgiven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's share the love of Jesus with those around us.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior is, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds a future and life I'll cross the river, I'll find life's final with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory, and I'll know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. Because I
All right, you may be seated for our scripture readings.
The Old Testament reading is Psalm 119, 33 through 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I will keep it to the end. Give me understanding that I may keep your law, and observe it with my whole heart. Lead me in the paths of your commandments, for I delight in it. Incline my heart to your testimonies, and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things. Give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise, that you may be feared. Turn away the reproach that I dread, for your rules are good. Behold, I long for your precepts. In your righteousness, give me life. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is Galatians 2, 19 through 21. For through the law I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness were through the law, then Christ died for no purpose. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able for the Holy Gospel.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 15th chapter. Jesus says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, so that you will love one another." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
You may be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
As we are, we continue our sermon series. The focus for the message today is John 15:13. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Talk about selfless service. Talk about a difficult passage for us to look at. And especially as we consider our sermon series, as we consider as we want to be. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Brian took us through the first part, I am limitless. And as he walked through the sermon, took us to the point where we realize I have limits. Last week, we started at the point where we feel like we are in control. And the message ended with the reality that I am not in control. Today, we're going to start from the perspective that so many of us want to be able to shout out to the world, I am selfless. And we're going to conclude with, I am broken and completely self-centered. As we want to be up against the reality of as we are, I have limits. I am not in control. I am self-centered and broken. My time in the military, selfless service is promoted and written down in the Army values. Selfless service is what brand new civilians, as they're introduced to the training environment and the Army value of selfless service, they are told over and over again. Put the welfare of the nation, the Army, and your subordinates before your own. That's a difficult thing. It's difficult to play out. It's difficult for brand new civilians who are coming into the Army who have the perspective of me, myself, and I. I am the most important. I've been told that all my life. Look out for number one. And all of a sudden, I show up for my training experience, and I'm told it's not about you. I'm told that my perspective needs to shift from that internal focus to look out and see that it's more about me. It's about we. It's about all of us who are together going through the same experience. And more than that, it's not about me. It's not about just we. It's about they. It's about those who benefit from those willing to serve in the military, our Army as a whole, the nation, those nations that we serve. It's a bigger picture. And so as soldiers come to their basic training experience, often they show up and within about a week, they want to say, I quit. It doesn't matter that I've swore an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. It doesn't matter that I signed my name on the paperwork, a contract obligating me to 3, 4, 6, 8 years in the military. None of that matters because when I encounter selfless service, I realize I'm self-centered to the core. I don't want to get woken up every morning and eat what I'm told to eat, do the exercises I'm told to do the training that I'm required to perform. I want out. I want to quit. But you know, many of our great civilians that enlist into the military turn out like these great soldiers here. Leaders in our military, and you can see from their uniforms that they have been selflessly serving for many, many years. The Army is great about awarding selfless service. We place awards and decorations on the uniform for those who are willing to selflessly serve. We give promotions. We give positions of responsibility for those who selflessly serve. As we look at these two individuals and their uniforms, we can see a history of their selfless service. We could even see service stripes on the left sleeve for number of years in the military, service stripes on the right sleeve for number of months in combat. But even for our leaders in the military who are in a culture of selfless service, the temptation is to become and continue to be self-centered, to start to think, I've earned all these medals that are placed on my chest. To begin to hear those words from great people who come up to you time and time again and say, thank you for your service. The temptation is to say, I deserve that thanks. And I deserve my discount at Home Depot. It is difficult to maintain a position of selfless service because everything we do in the military comes with awards and decorations and promotions. And before you know it, even the most selfless leaders become self-centered, become worried about their own promotions, start to look at the uniforms of their fellow service members and compare and take notes of what you have that I don't have or what I have that you don't have. And we forget that we're on the same team. And we start to compete and jockey for position to get the next rank, to get the next promotion, to get the next secure job. Selfless service is met with our self-centeredness. And even those serving in the military have to face the reality that I am self-centered. And as we've been walking through these last few weeks, we've been using David Zoll's book, Low Anthropology, to give us a perspective on the depth of the sinfulness of our human condition. And in his chapter on self-centeredness, he brings us this perspective. Human beings are egocentric. This is not a neutral trait. You see, it'd be one thing if my self-centeredness only impacted and affected me. But it is quite another thing to realize that my self-centeredness impacts and affects everyone around me. As leaders in the military serve, the soldiers who serve under them recognize two kinds of leaders. Those who are selfless, those who put the needs of others above their own, those who don't care about the awards and decorations on their chest, those who aren't worried about the next promotion and how to get the next best job, but those who are truly concerned with everyone else. You see, the self-centered leaders spend all their time trying to figure out how to be better than the one that they're competing with for promotion. They spend all of their time pushing their subordinates out front and saying things aren't going right because of them. I'm doing everything I need to do. And that self-centeredness plays out and is not a neutral trait. In fact, the Army, as they started analyzing and looking at leaders within the military, and I can't believe it took until 2019, but in 2019, the Army updated their leadership doctrine, and they added two traits of leadership that had not been talked about for a couple hundred years. Those two traits, humility and empathy. You see, even the United States Army has realized that leaders, as we become self-centered, lose our ability to have empathy for the other, and we lose our humility, and it becomes all about us. But it's not like that in the church, is it? We're good to go as Christians. We don't have that kind of a problem. Well, Jesus gives his definition of selfless service. He says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you." That you love one another as I have loved you. For us, life as Christians, it's not one about promotions and awards and decorations. It's about selflessly serving our neighbor. But you know, that self-centeredness that is part of who we are, that sin sickness that lies so deep within, it can start to come out as we begin to compare ourselves and our selfless service to all those other self-centered Christians out there. And in my mind, I can begin to create my own ribbon and medal rack where I place all my awards and decorations for the selfless service that I'm doing in my congregation and in my community. I can start to see my life as a Christian as one where I gain bonus points with God because of my selfless service. I start to give myself little stars and promotion points for every time I go to a service or attend a Bible class. And before we know it, I begin in my self-centeredness to look out and see all of you in your self-centeredness, and I start to compare. I look at what I'm done and what I'm doing, and I look at you, and I say, well, your self-centeredness is worse than mine. And we end up in a difficult situation. And we go back to our definition from David Zoll. Human beings are egocentric. This is not a neutral trait. In our self-centeredness, we can begin to cause all kinds of problems within our families, within our congregation, even within our community. That disease that we have of self-centeredness impacts us so radically that it bleeds over and impacts everyone around us. And in the middle of that, Jesus sees our self-centeredness and responds with forgiveness. Jesus sees our self-centeredness, and he is the ultimate example of selfless service. As he says, greater love has no one than this, that he give up his life for his friends. He turns to us. And despite our self-centeredness, he calls us his friends. In his humility and his empathy for us, he goes to the cross so that he can give us forgiveness. He calls us his friends. He forgives our self-centeredness. The great part about this is, the more firmly we recognize who we are, that we have limits, that we are not in control, and I am at the core self-centered, the more my focus can change from me to we to they. Just like that new recruit that comes to basic training, and they eventually realize that the me of who they are is a United States soldier, we realize that the me of who we are is one chosen by God. We realize the me of who we are is a friend of Jesus. We realize that the me of who we are is someone forgiven by Jesus. My self-centeredness, greater than all of yours. And then we can begin to shift that perspective from looking to the me to looking to the we with new eyes. And seeing your self-centeredness as less than my self-centeredness And I can have renewed compassion and empathy because my sins are forgiven. And then we can transition from the me to the we to the they. As we look at our community and we see people who are struggling with self-centeredness, and we can take them Jesus' words of forgiveness. We can share with them that they are friends of Him. And we can tell them that He chose them. They haven't chosen God. And in the middle of all of that, the selfless servant, Jesus Christ, receives all the glory. May God's peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. I invite you all to please stand as we continue our service with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty.
You may be seated as we continue with the time to worship God with our tithes and offerings.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if He did. All authority, every victory is yours. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, for you Jesus, awesome and power forever, awesome and great is your name, you overcame. Okay. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcomes. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all of our praise, you overcame. Jesus, awesome and
let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, you know our predicament. You know that we can't stop being selfish. But what you do know is that Jesus, your only begotten Son, that he loves perfectly, that he did lay down his life for his friends, that he is perfectly selfless. And then you give us the righteousness, the glory of Jesus. You give to us his selflessness that we may stand as your people. Lord, may we seek to put all the glory to Jesus. May we seek to understand that we are continually selfish, that other people are plagued by that same selfishness. But that we may see them the way Jesus sees us, that we may see them with grace, we may give them mercy. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, our friends, our family members, our neighbors, Dave, Frank, Rylan, Dale, Alfred, Alexis, Mel, Marcia, Carl, Johnny, Logan, Claudia, Lillian, and Mr. Lip are suffering from sickness. Lord, we pray that you would lead their medical teams to make the right decisions, that you'd strengthen their bodies, but more than that, you would strengthen their faith in Jesus. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, we get to worship you openly without fear of retribution, and so we thank you for the service of those who continue to provide this safety for us. We thank you for the service of Tucker, Jaden, James, John, Eli, Preston, Garrett, Dylan, Tavian, Cole, Mark, Chris, Reed, and Jared. Lord, protect them in body and in soul. Protect them as they serve and when they come home. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Father, this month we will be celebrating Church Worker Appreciation. And Lord, we here at Trinity have been blessed with many different ministries that continue day in and day out to speak of the good news of Jesus. Now, this weekend, Lord, we lift before you our childcare ministry, and we want to express thankfulness to you for raising up workers for this vital ministry. And so we thank you and we pray for Josh, Amy, Tammy, Shannon, Heidi, Chase, Diana, Hollis, Michelle, Tori, Jessica, Jeanette, Shelley, Suzanne, Haley, Lainey, Connie, Jesse, and Katie. Lord, you have prepared many good works beforehand that they may walk in them. Lord, we pray that you would continue to bless them with the Holy Spirit, that they may pursue the good of these kids every day. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Heavenly Father, there are those among us who've lost loved ones. We lift before you the family of Jack and the Eliason family who've both suffered recent losses. Lord, Your promise is that death has met its match in Jesus, that you are victorious, that the slavery of death is broken. And so, Lord, as we await that day, the day of your return, it's good and right that we should pray in eager anticipation, as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We have three First Communion celebrants this morning, so come on down. We got, there they come. All right, so here, all the joy. You're wearing a button-up shirt, bro. Yes! Wow. Where's my phone? I got to get a picture. You're looking sharp. Hairs all fly. What's up? Hey, guys. You ready? Don't worry. No one's watching. Maybe. All right. You've already been through the questions, so we'll just roll through these. All of you have been prepared. You've learned all about this sacrament. You're in confirmation, so let's do this. Do you believe in one triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is the only true God?
Yes, I believe in the triune God.
Do you believe that you are a sinner, that you have fallen short of God's expectations for your life? Have your thoughts, words, and deeds done harm to those around you? And do you desire to live well and bless those around you? Do you believe that faith in Jesus Christ, true God and true man, is the only way to be free from your sins?
Jesus Christ, the Son of God, died on the cross to wash away all my sins. He alone gives
us. Good job. Do you believe Jesus offers you life and salvation as a free gift through faith? Do you believe that Jesus is really present in the Lord's Supper, in, with, and under the bread and wine? Do you believe that he is present in the sacrament offering you the forgiveness of sins?
Yes, Jesus is clear when he teaches us that we need to see his blood in the sacrament.
Do you desire to do less harm to the people in your life, to live well and bless those around you? Do you aspire to love others the way Jesus loves you? All right, last question. Whew, it's been a long one, huh? You're holding up great. Do you intend to be frequent and faithful in celebrating the victory of Jesus in word and sacrament? Amen. All right, let's stand on our feet and pray for these guys. Don't move. We've got to pray for you first. Dear Jesus, we rejoice that your Holy Spirit has been given to Lakin, to Lyndon, and to Devin. Lord, they are your children, and they have grown in the faith. They've come to this big moment in their life, a big moment here for us at Trinity. Lord, I pray for the church that we would continue to support their growth and for their confirmation process, that they would continue to grow in the faith and celebrate the love of Jesus. Bless them this morning, Lord, as they commune with us for the first time. In your most holy and sacred name, we pray. Amen. All right, guys, you can go sit with your families, and we will continue. I'm sure we're listening to all of their questions and answers. Every week we do a shortened version to help us prepare to receive this gift, and so we will continue. Friends, it was on that night, the night that Jesus reclined at table with his disciples celebrating the great feast of Passover. And as they did so, Jesus took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. As he did, he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Take and drink. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may be seated.
You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. And if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out with the same old fight. We've all run to things we know that just ain't right. There's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, He's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. Somebody testify. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. chain breaker. He's a chain breaker. Savior, I come, quiet my soul. Remember redemption's hell, your blood was spilled. My ransom, everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me. Lead me to Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before Him. For He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross the river. I'll find life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because I know a future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
All right, so we're going to hear these words, then you're going to sing these words. Are you ready? Oh, guys. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift his face unto you and give you now and forever his peace. Amen. Let's sing the blessing.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face towards you and give you peace. Favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and and their children, and their children. May His presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in the coming, and the going, in your weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you, 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 not against you.
Friends, go in peace and praise the Lord. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia.